Nash Equilibrium and Evolutionary Stable Strategy. Welcome. We will talk now about two concepts that are very important in this context. The references are a couple of chapters from Easley and Kleinberg and one chapter from Novak. So we are getting used to the representation of payoffs in a theoretical game using a payoff matrix, which may be in one of these two forms. Is a very good exercise for you to be able to write one form from the other form. Here we're representing two strategies denoted by the letter S and the letter T. And the payoffs are represented in a general form with values A, B, C, and D. Okay, so let's see. We are going to use this representation of payoffs to introduce some definitions. Okay, so here's the first definition of an equilibrium, specifically a Nash equilibrium, named after John Nash. Two players play a strategy that is a Nash equilibrium when it is not possible for them to deviate, to move away from this strategy and increase their payoff. In other words, in a sense, they are locked in. There is nothing else they can play other than this one strategy with the ultimate goal of increasing their payoff. That is the main thing on these games, right? So remember, the game requires having players, having strategies that the players are going to play, and there are expected returns or payoffs. And that's what the players are going after, maximizing their payoff. So this idea of equilibrium comes from thinking that once you play this strategy, there is absolutely nothing else that could be played that would increase payoffs. And in that sense, players are locked in. It's like being frozen, right? That's that deadlock or something like that. So that idea of being frozen is what brings about this notion of an equilibrium. Another way of phrasing Nash equilibrium is by referring to not one strategy, but referring to a pair of strategies. Say, for example, S and T. We say the pair is a Nash equilibrium if S is the best response to T and T is the best response to S. In other words, one strategy is the best response to another strategy, while another strategy is the best response to this one strategy. Okay, so that's the idea of being in some type of locked in deadlock situation. So if players choose strategies that are best responses to each other, then no player has an incentive to deviate to an alternative strategy. And the game is in an equilibrium state because there is no force pushing the game towards a different outcome. Okay, so this kind of wraps up these ideas of being at equilibrium. Okay. We had been using the word equilibrium as an analogy for steady state. With differential equation models, equilibrium is defined, is associated by the state in which there is no change. So with a differential equation model, an equilibrium is this one point at which the derivative equals zero, meaning that there is no change. Okay. Here, the idea of equilibrium is summarized in with these words. The game's at equilibrium state because there is no other force that would push the game towards a different outcome. Now, we would say that using this general form of the payoff matrix, the strategy S is a Nash equilibrium if A is greater than or equal to C. So here is the payoff of A. So A is the payoff obtained by a player that is playing the strategy S against another player that's also playing the same strategy S, and each of these players would get the payoff of this level, of this value of A. Now, if that value is bigger, if this value is here, if this value A is bigger than little c, right? If A is bigger than C, then The payoff from playing S is larger than the payoff from playing D against S, right? So in that case, we would say that that strategy S is a Nash equilibrium. If you have that, it is actually a strict inequality. If it's A is strictly bigger than C, then you would call S a strict Nash equilibrium. We can also say that a pair of strategies, S, S, forms a Nash equilibrium if A is greater than or equal to C. Okay, so we can refer as one strategy being an equilibrium, or we can refer to a pair of strategies being an equilibrium, just as we mentioned when we are defining Nash equilibrium before. Now, for this matrix or this matrix, we say that T, the other strategy, is a Nash equilibrium according to the values. Now we're going to compare the values. Now we're comparing the values of D and B, right? So we're going to say that if D is greater than or equal to B, then T is a Nash equilibrium, or we can say that the pair T, T is a Nash equilibrium if D is greater than or equal to B. We can also use the strict Nash, the definition of strict Nash equilibrium, which applies if you have a strict inequality. Now, consider a population of players that are playing strategy S, okay? And assume that there is a mutant of type T, which is introduced into this large population of S players. So let's assume that there is an infinitesimal density. That's the idea, that this mutant is introduced at a really tiny, tiny small, it's an itty bitty small level of mutants with the strategy T being introduced into the population. So it's an infinitesimal amount, which we denote here by epsilon. Okay, this epsilon is a number between 0 and 1, but is probably closer to 0 than it is to 1. That's the idea of being infinitesimal. So we would say that things that are T, that is frequency epsilon of T players, the invaders, then the rest, right, is going to be 1 minus epsilon. So clearly epsilon plus 1 minus epsilon equals 1. So we're going to say that there are epsilon of these players are T players and 1 minus epsilon are S players. So what we do now that we have this, we multiply the matrix with the values of payoff, okay, by the vector with densities. Remember here, the first quantity is the density of S, the second quantity is the density of players in T. When we carry out this matrix vector multiplication, this is the first row times this column that gives you A minus A times quantity 1 minus epsilon plus B epsilon, and the second entry you get C times quantity 1 minus epsilon plus D epsilon. So this is now what we call the fitness vector. This is F1 and F2. Okay, this is from our previous calculations. Now the fitness of the S strategy is, so we're looking at, again, this represents the densities of players with S and T, which means that this would represent F1 or F sub S, the fitness of strategy S, right? So the fitness of strategy S is greater, meaning this quantity would be greater than the fitness of strategy T if the first value of fitness is greater than the second value of fitness. So if A is greater than C, then the fitness of S exceeds the fitness of T. If A is exactly equal to C, and so this goes together, A equals Z and B is strictly bigger than D, then the fitness of S is greater than the fitness of T. So this then this conditions brings us to a definition of another quantity that's called evolutionary stable strategy. So we would say the strategy S is evolutionary stable if either one of two conditions are met. One, either A is strictly bigger than C, or A is equal to C and B is equal to D. If that happens, we say that S is an evolutionary stable strategy. The definition of this is also called ESS, evolutionary stable strategy. This definition guarantees that selection will oppose the invasion of T into S. Okay? So let's consider this scenario. We have this is the example that we have been dissecting, using it for several different instances. So let's go back to that example of the body size in the population of beetles. There were two strategies. One, they were phenotypes, small and large. So if a few large beetles are introduced into a population of small beetles, then the large beetles will do extremely well. Remember that here the body size was a main driving factor in the competitions for food. The food competitions, these were pairwise competitions. Two beetles meeting each other, the bigger guy kind of had a better chance of keeping most of the food or something, right? So what happens, let's examine that in the context of invasion, right? In the context of evolutionary stability. So since they rarely meet each other, then they get most of the food in almost every competition they experience, right? So we're talking about the large beetles, right? When large meets large, then there is a significantly smaller payoff as what they get out of those nutrients of food, right? Significantly smaller when compared to when large meets small, right? So since large doesn't meet large that often, so they have an evolutionary advantage. The population of small beetles cannot drive out the large size beetles. So the strategy small is not evolutionary stable. Okay? Strategy small is not evolutionary stable. From the strategy payoff matrix, what we have here, we have that 5, this entry, is less than this entry, okay, which violates the definition of evolutionary stable strategy. So this does not satisfy the definition of evolutionary stable strategy. Now, consider the following payoff matrix, right? In this case, what is different? The values here, small against small is 5, large against large is 3. Let's see here, large against large is still 3, small against small is still 5. So these values are the same values, but now I'm sorting the strategies here on a different order. I list large first, small second, large first, small second. I want to do that just to show you something that is consistent with the way in which we listed the definitions. If we now consider the payoff matrix in this form, same values, but we rearranged the order of the strategies, were consistent, right? This strategy goes first here, this strategy goes second, and then across the columns, we keep that we are consistent with the order. This strategy goes first, this strategy goes second. Okay, so clearly here 3 is bigger than 1, and that implies that the definition of evolutionary stable strategy applies in this sense. So strategy large is evolutionary stable. Let's digest this. In other words, in a population of large beetles, a few small beetles will do very badly, okay? So in a population of large beetles, now we think of the majority of the population having the phenotype of large body size. If we introduce an infinitesimal amount of beetles with small body size, then those small beetles are gonna do terrible. They will have a clear disadvantage in food competitions, right? And they're going to be losing almost every competition for food because of their body size. The population of large beetles resists the invasion of small beetles because the large phenotype is considered an evolutionary stable strategy. So given a matrix of this form with values A, B, C, and D, we say that a pair S, S is a Nash equilibrium when S is the best response to the choice of S by the other player. We can also equivalently state that S, S is a Nash equilibrium if A is strictly bigger than, I mean, if A is greater than or equal to C. So you're comparing the payoffs on here in the first column, right? That's what we have been working with. We can also say that that this is an evolutionary stable strategy if A is strictly bigger than C, or if A is equal to C and B, these two things can be the same, and you have that B is strictly bigger than D. So if a strategy is evolutionary stable, then S, if a strategy S is evolutionary stable, then the pair of strategies S, S is a Nash equilibrium. And this concludes our discussion on the concepts of Nash equilibrium and evolutionary stable strategies. Thank you.